हरि ओम। जिसके शरीर में मैं प्रविष्ट हुआ था वह प्राणी और मेरा शरीर ये दोनों कहाँ गए, क्यों मुझे प्राप्त नहीं हुए? मैंने स्थावर पर्यंत अपने विस्तार पूर्ण संसार मंडल में चिरकाल तक भ्रमण किया, फिर भी बाहर निकलने का मार्ग गले के छिद्र मुझे नहीं मिला। यह सब मैंने मुनि के समीप जाकर उनसे पूछा। महाशय मुनि महाराज ने मुझसे कहा है, कमल नयन, शरीर का वृत्तांत मुझसे उपदिष्ट उपाय के बिना ही तुम स्वयं अपने बुद्धि से कैसे जान गए? तो उसके दर्शन का क्या उपाय है? यदि तुम योग से एकाग्र बुद्धि से उसका स्वयं अवलोकन करते हो तो ज्ञान दृष्टि से इसे करस्थित कमल के समान संपूर्णतः देखते ही हो। फिर भी यदि मेरे वचन से इसे सुनने की तुम्हारी इच्छा है तो सुनो। जैसे घटना घटी है उसे आद्योपांत संपूर्णतया तुमसे करता हूँ। When that householder wanted, got the enlightenment and then he wanted to go and see his old body and his disciple's body in the forest, he became one with the air and he roamed about whole sky, whole universe, but he could not get the way out, the way through the throat. And then he comes back to the great wise man, the stranger yogi, and asks why I did not get the way out. The yogi replies, without my advice, without knowing from me how to get out and what is the body, how is the body, you tried to get out, you could not. So if you can use your knowledge eyes, then you can see the body, and then you can know something about getting out. And if you want to hear from me, I am telling about the body in details. पहले तुम अपने जीव तत्व को समझो। इन द बिगिनिंग इटसेल्फ यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड द मीनिंग, रियल मीनिंग ऑफ इंडिविजुअल बींग, देन ओनली यू विल अंडरस्टैंड एवरीथिंग। अप टू दिस वी सॉ यस्टरडे व्हाट इज द इंडिविजुअल बींग एंड व्हाट इज ए बॉडी, what is a body, and also we shall see the relation of the being with the body. That means the being means here we can say soul for some time, but really the being is not a soul. Being means jiva, jiva we say, the individual soul. So now he says, पहले तुम अपने जीव तत्व को समझो, उसके बाद मैं तुम्हारे पूर्व शरीर का वृत्तांत कहूँगा। First of all, you try to understand the real meaning of individual being, and then I shall tell you about the body. ऐसा सोच रहे मुनि जी, व्यष्टि जीव भाव मिथ्या है, समष्टि जीव भाव ही सत्य है। यह त्रीणि रूपाणि त्येव सत्यम्। इस श्रुति से प्रदर्शित न्याय का अवलंबन कर कहते हैं, त्रीणि रूपाणि इति एव सत्यम्, तीन रूप ही सच है, ये श्रुति कहता है। वी फाइंड इन वेदर्स दैट द सेइंग ऑफ वेदर्स, थ्री बॉडीज आर, थ्री फॉर्म्स आर ट्रू, अदर्स नॉट। व्हाट आर दीज थ्री बॉडी, थ्री फॉर्म्स, त्रीणी रूपाणी फॉर्म्स, थ्री फॉर्म्स आर ओनली ट्रू, अदर्स आर नॉट ट्रू। एंड ही सेज the individual being who is not real and the universal being who is real. And in Vedanta we always mean jiva means universal as well as individual. And yesterday we have discussed the scientific view and philosophical view are one and the same about the being. Philosophically, jeev means it is one only, and it is seen in many forms. One seen in many forms. That means universal being is true and individual beings are only appearances, they are not true. This is what he wants to explain. And scientifically also, the structural form of the whole universe is same as the atom. So scientifically also same, there is no difference. And why then these atoms are made and seen? How and why? All these questions arises. तुम जैसे कि अपने को समझते हो वैसे व्यष्टि रूप नहीं हो, किंतु सकल प्राणियों के तप रूपी कमलों को विकसित करने में सूर्य रूप सकल कल्याणों के मानुष आनंद से लेकर प्रजापत्य आनंद पर्यंत सुखों के कमला करके समान समष्टि रूप हरि भगवान के नाभि कमल की कर्णिका यानी कर्णिका में आरूढ़ सर्वजीव समष्टि रूप हिरण्यगर्भ ही हो। He says, as you think yourself as individual being is really not true. हाँ जी, कहाँ पर? अच्छा, तो अच्छा सिरोर के तरफ, हाँ नैतला सिरोर, ये दोनों गांव कवर करो, वापस आ जाओ। और फिर कहेंगे तो हम इसको भेज देंगे अवतार को। जी जी ठीक, फिर बंद हो गया रहता कल का बारिश में, नैतालों के पास बंद, वो दलदल हो गया, कल का बारिश था। सो ही सेज, आज यू थिंक टू बी इंडिविजुअल बीइंग इन ए वेरी वेरी लिमिटेड स्मॉल स्केल इज नॉट रियल। द रियलिटी इज योर फॉर्म इज यूनिवर्सल फॉर्म। फ्रॉम साइंस एंड फिलोसफी बोथ हुए वी सी इट। सो योर फॉर्म इज मेड स्ट्रक्चरली इक्वल टू द यूनिवर्सल फॉर्म only, and then the question comes, why and how we think we are so limited and so narrow, so small, why, how, from where it has come. So the answer is not one. The answer is confusive and so many answers are there. But all the answers are not true. Why? Because everything is confusive. You see, when we see the forms in the cloud, whether the forms are true or false, if we say something, why this form is visible, and how it is visible, what answer will be there? Whatever you say is not true, because the form is not true. So this is one way of understanding. Other way of understanding is, you see, once whatever is happened, if you go on thinking it again and again, it becomes a habit and it takes a form and a name. So even if you have no form, no name, if you go on thinking, I have a form, I have a name, it will appear before you. So repeated practice, habitual practice, brings the name and form. Names and forms are not real. Then what is real? On what basis it stands? The reality is existence and bliss and knowledge of it. That means consciousness, awareness of existence. So these three aspects are true. And then when it goes on repeatedly experienced, then it creates a name and a form. Or first a form and then a name. There are so many stories on this. If you go on telling the lie repeatedly for a long time, that lie, that false statement becomes true for you. And on this, there are stories. Once somebody, some villager, he purchased a goat and he was coming to his house. And in the way, some cheaters, they saw the goat, it is very filthy and it is very good for killing and making meat and good dishes. सो हाउ टू चीट दिस मैन एंड गेट द गोट. दे मेड ए प्लान एंड दे वर स्टैंडिंग इन द वे इन लिटिल distances. And first man says, when he sees this fellow bringing the goat, he asks, oh my dear friend, where from you are coming? I am coming from that village. Oh, this is so beautiful dog. Where from you have brought? He is telling the goat to be dog. Oh, such a beautiful dog. Where from you have brought? Is it dog? What do you see? Are you a blind man? How can you tell it a dog? It is a goat, don't you see? He laughed. Achha, achha. It is a goat for you. Achha, whether I am unable to see or you are unable to see. You think it is a goat? Okay, if you think it, take it. What does it matter to me? But it is really very beautiful dog. I like it. I wanted to ask you, I can also purchase such a dog. I was in search of a dog. So the man says, go, go your way. It is not a dog, it is a goat. Then he goes further. After a while, another person meets him. Oh, my dear friend, where from you brought this beautiful dog? Oh, it looks, see, its ears, how beautiful. And can it bark well, and what all qualities it has got? I wanted a dog. Can you give it to me? Whatever I like it. Whatever money you ask, I will give you. Please give this dog to me. Where from you brought it? What do you say? Is this a dog? Don't you see, it is a goat. Oh, fool. You think it is a goat? Okay, maybe in your language you call the dog as a goat. I don't know your language. You see? Okay. But anyhow, I like this dog. And if you take whatever money you ask, I am ready to give it. And can you give this dog to me? This man thinks, are, that man was telling it is a dog. This man also is telling it is a dog. What has happened to my mind? Has that man cheated me? Huh? And how I am seeing this as a goat? Have I got any disease in my eyes? So slowly doubts in his own self rises, and he is doubting his own belief. And when he advances, goes a little further, the third man comes forward. The members of the cheating gang. Oh, my dear friend, you are a good man. Why are you taking this dog with you? You have tied it, and the dogs always follow you, and you have tied it and dragging it. What has happened to this dog? Huh? Of course, it is so beautiful, and where it looks, see its color, it looks so nice. हैव यू ब्रॉट इट फ्रॉम योर होम टू सेल इट? वेयर आर यू गोइंग? वेयर फ्रॉम यू ब्रॉट इट? इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सेल, आई एम रेडी टू परचेज. एंड मेनी पीपल वेयर सर्चिंग फॉर सम डॉग्स बिकॉज वी वॉन्ट टू वॉच अवर हाउस एट नाइट. I wanted a dog. This seems to be a very nice dog. Can you give it to me? Oh fool, what are you telling? This is a goat. Oh, I am a fool. You think I am a fool? Are you not blind? What has happened to your eyes? How dare you say a dog to be a goat? Okay. If you are blind, I am not going to be blind. And ask so many persons are there. What is it? Is it a dog or a goat? Then this man thinks, oh, something has gone wrong with me. Everybody is telling it is a dog. So if I take this dog to my house, my children, my wife, they will abuse me. What has happened to your brain? They will see this dog, and when I say I have brought this goat, they will drive me out from house. So it is better to untie it here, let it go, let me be saved. Of course, whatever money I have given, never mind. And he untied the goat and he went without the goat, and from the back all these three, those two were following hidingly. What is happening? Let us see. And three of them got together, took the goat, and had a beautiful lunch. So this is some story to tell. If something is repeated again and again, it creates some, it appears to be true, and it creates something. Creates some influence on your mind, and mind gets some ideas that this is the truth, and that is how we are seeing this world as many. When we come to our own body, we see, if I see you, what am I seeing? You means your personality, your body. Am I seeing Gajanan, or I am seeing your Gajanan's face, or Gajanan's hands, or his belly, or legs, or ears, or eyes? What am I seeing? I am seeing everything at a time, and I am thinking, this is all Gajanan. And where is Gajanan? Whether the hands are Gajanan, without hands also Gajanan is there, without belly also Gajanan is there, without everything Gajanan is there, yet I think Gajanan is this form, name. The name is this form. Likewise, we can see the tree. What is a tree? Is it the leaves, foliage, flowers, buds, small branches, fruits, or the trunk, or the roots, or whole of it? What do you see? We see the tree as a whole, and we see the tree in many parts also. So also whether the manyness is true or oneness is true. What do you really understand by telling a tree? Whole totality is a tree, but you don't see whole totality at a time. You see part by part, and yet you see it is a tree. So always confusion, and yet some name and form is there. Really speaking, it was not tree little ago, and it will not be a tree little afterwards. And it was once a small plant. Before that, it was a small seedling. And before that, it was just a seed. And before seed, it was some fruit. And before fruit, it was some flower. Again, coming to the circle of confusion goes on and on. Whether the tree is true, whether the seed is true, whether the fruit is true, nobody knows what is true. The circle of confusion goes on and on. So this is how the mind creates the confusion, and by practice, by habit, by repetition, we see something and we think it is the truth. That is how the individual being is made from other angle we have seen. And what happens from technical angle of view? What is mind? Mind is nothing but a motion of some energy. Energy means vibration. A vibration, continuous vibration that appears to be a flow or a motion. The continuous vibration appears to be a flow. So that vibration, that waves are called thoughts. And this is how we understand mind, technically. And every wave will have different frequencies. And it goes on. And how it is created? It is created by the throbbing, by pushing or vibrating, by the vibration created by the prana in the brain cells, not everywhere. Mind is not created in the heart or in the hands or legs, but in the brain cells. Just as now practically we will see. See, this is one object. Say two sets. What happened actually, scientifically? What happened? When one is clashed with the other, some vibration is created, and that we call it a sound. And see, do you feel the difference? In the beginning it was more, and slowly it comes down and disappears. yet there is vibration. So from this we can understand scientifically that when two things dash with each other, some vibration is created by friction. Some vibration is created, and that vibrations are always, it is vibration means some waves are created in the air, and those waves are slowly they subside, and they are different, each is different from the other, and it is so continuous, we cannot grossly, we cannot find out whether it is different waves or it is a flow of waves. Minutely when we analyze, we can understand there are different waves, and each wave is different from the other. And now this is one kind of sound, the other kind of sound, see. And the other kind of sound. So many kinds of sounds, we name it differently, and in music we make it technically, rhythmically, and we call it music. And the whole world, if we analyze, then nothing but play of energy, and that is in the form of sound, in the form of electricity, magnetism. Many names we have given, but everything is only vibrations. And vibration is nothing but energy, and that is created because of, grossly because of disturbance. Disturbance is scientifically said as clashing with each other, objects clashing with each other. If it is away from each other, there is no sound. If it is clashing with each other, then there will be sound or vibration. It creates no vibration. So when prana is disturbed or it is dashed with the walls of the brain cells, it creates some vibration. And those vibrations, there are so many cells in the brain, that's why it is called sahasrara. Thousands of cells are there, very minute. And the doctors, they see it by microscope. And yet it is gross only. Those cells are vibrated by prana, and thoughts are created, and it goes on. Goes on and on, because prana is continuously working. So the thought process also is a continuous process. We feel sometimes at the time of deep sleep, thoughts are subsided, mind is resting, but prana never rests. Prana never rests. What happens then? That is another subject. What happens to the mind? Whether it is stopped or it is in some other form. Now coming to our habit, when this mind means the thought waves are created, they cannot be stagnant. Wave means it has to change its position. Wave means it has to change its position. Changing the position is called motion. It is here, then here, then here, then here. So it goes on. That is called motion or action. Whatever you say, action is motion. Motion is action. We have two names, two words. We understand it differently, but the meaning is same. Without change, you cannot have motion. Without change, you cannot act. Without motion also, you cannot act. So all these are synonymous terms. Now the mind has to move, means thought waves have to move. Where will it move? It has to move in the space. And then where will it, up to what limit it will go on? Where it is obstructed, up to that limit, up to the limit of obstruction, it will go on moving continuously. So it is created in the brain cells and it has to move. So it moves and it goes out. Brain is called in and out is called body's outward field. That means beyond body. So beyond body, to go out, the gateway is senses. Whether ear, eyes, nose, or the skin, somehow or other, it goes out of the body and we call it going out. The senses are the gateways. Now remember, he was searching for a way out. Searching for a way out. So body is said to be some object, and then we can understand what is in and out. If there is no demarcating line, then there is no in and out. In means inside the line. Line of, say, in the room, line is the door or the walls. If you are in the room, that means inside the walls or inside the door. If you go out of the door, then it is understood as you have gone out of the room. So in and out is considered by demarcating lines. Without the limitations or demarcations, you cannot understand what is in and out. Now you are sitting here. Whether you are in or out, if I say this much, not the room, if I don't use the word room, what will you understand? Whether you are in or out, nothing is understood. And if I put a line or some partition, then you are in or out. That side, you are out of that side and you are inside of this side. Something we understand. So without the boundary lines, demarcating lines or limiting lines. We don't understand what is in and out. So these senses work as gateway and the body works as limit. So the mind goes out, and how far it will go, that means the vibrations go out, and how far it will go up to its first obstruction. Say I am seeing, the seeing means the mind's waves are going out, and when it is obstructed, that is obstructed by the wall, it is an object. So it has to come back again. It has to be sometimes with it, and then it has to come back to its source. So they say the thought works as boomerang. Boomerang, the Australian waves, Australian weapon used in olden days. Some weapon, they throw it to kill somebody or do harm to somebody, and it comes back to the person who has thrown it. And this was the practice in the olden days with our kings and our warriors. They had a kind of weapons, either arrows or other weapons. If they throw it with a will power or a mantra, then it will hit the object and it will come back to them. This was the olden practice in India also. Rama fought with so many demons in the Dandakaranya forest, and with Ravan so many demons were killed. How many arrows he had? He did not borrow any arrows from somebody. Hari Om. Mataji, Jai Ho. Ji. Jarur karenge. जी अच्छा अच्छा जी जी खन्ना साहेब अच्छा हाँ हाँ जी 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 अच्छा जी 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 हाँ माता जी, इतना आप कर रहे हैं फिर भी ये समस्या क्या होता होगा लोगों को? कुछ कुछ पैसा लेना देना होता है? भगवान, चलो गुरुदेव के ऊपर छोड़ देते हैं, जो कुछ होगा होगा। अच्छा है गुरुदेव, बड़ी कृपा माता जी, बड़ी कृपा, जय हो। अभी भी लाइन में है वो, अभी नहीं हो पा रहा। जयपाल, जयपाल, जयपाल लाइन में, उनका एक के बाद दूसरा होता रहता है ऑपरेशन। नहीं हुआ अभी तक, सब चीज तैयार, जान चीज नटपन। सविता माता जी थी सुप्रीम कोर्ट लॉयर, she herself went and told his friend some doctor, even then they are not doing it,
waiting man,
waiting, waiting. And she says every day fight goes on. People are so much troubled. Anyway, so now this obstruction is called object, or object obstructs both ways. And how this object is created? Who has created this object? And what happens when the waves go and dash against the object? What happens? This is the theory, analytical theory of perception. Perception, how we perceive an object. The wave goes and dashes against the object, and in two ways it becomes one with the object. Two ways. One is covering it all around, this is the object. If the hand goes and dashes against it, it has to become one with the object. It can become one with the object in this way, covering the object from all the sides. Just as the amoeba catches its prey, the amoeba, it comes near the prey and it surrounds it from all sides and takes it in and digests it. And it can become wider, or it can spread all around the prey. So that way the thought wave goes and knows the object. And the other way is to enter into it and becomes and spread inside everywhere the object, and then it can become one with it. It encircles the object or enters into the object. Both way is possible. But generally what happens with ordinary beings, the thought waves go and encircles the object, and it knows something about the object and comes back. It never enters into it. when it enters into it, becomes one with it. That is, from yogic point of view, what yogis can do, that is called sanyam. If it can remain for long time near the object and try to enter in, then only it will become one with the object fully. That is called sanyam. With one-pointed mind only. One-pointed mind means one thought only should get associated with the object and it should enter into the object. Then it knows the properties, the structural form, the nature of the object fully well. That is called real knowledge. And then it comes back to the source, or else just it goes and dashes against the object and comes back, or little while it encircles it and comes back, and if it touches it also, it knows something. So our knowledge, that means knowledge of the object, is haphazard all the time, because it goes and comes back, because it is obstructed. And that way we get a haphazard knowledge of the object all the time. Why? Because other waves are waiting. they have to be associated with other objects or the same object anyway. But other waves are already created. So they have to go, they have to do their duties. That means they have to activate. So if other waves are not created, then only this wave will be allowed to be with the object for longer time. Did you follow? That means if the mind is not creating many waves, many thoughts, then only one thought will be persistent. Or else, if other waves are created, other thoughts are created, then those thoughts also will do their work. Work means perceiving some object, that means to go, and they have to be obstructed by some object, and they will get back the information. That information is called impression. Impression of the object, how it is. So now I looked at my thought wave goes out of the eyes, that means I am seeing the object, and then it dashes against the clock and it comes back. So what did I know about the clock? Just some time. Time means about the hour hand and the minute hand or the second hand, that much. And about something about the figures. Or maybe little about the screen. That much. A little more maybe about the frame of the clock. What is inside, I don't know. Because the thought is not entering into the clock. So, if it wants to enter in and know everything about it, then it has to stay for longer time. Longer time means this perception becomes in the fraction of second, thousands part of a second. This is so quick. And if you can stop your vibration of the prana, that means thought process, that means not creating many thought waves. And if that one thought wave is persistingly there with the object, then it will know more about the object. That's how technically Raja Yoga says, Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. Nirodha means to obstruct, not to destroy. Nirodha means just to obstruct the thought waves and make only one wave for longer time. That is called concentration. And it is dealt technically and how to do, what to do. So this is what is called perception, perception. Now, what is that object, where from it came? Who created this object? And why this thought wave goes on? How, why it is created? Say, we say that thought waves are created by prana, and prana dashes against the walls of the brain cells and creates some vibrations that are, those are called thoughts. Okay, now we have understood up to this. Then why the prana goes there and dashes? Why it should be? Why it should do all this? Because prana itself is a wavery understanding. Prana itself is energy. Energy means wave. Energy means wave, and it has to move. Mind also is energy, and prana also is energy. One energy.
Prana is universal. How can it
move? Wait. I am coming to it. It is so complicated. So prana is a type of energy. It is transferred into another type of energy. That is called mind. The mind also is energy. And prana also is energy. Just like electricity is energy, it creates the light. So light also is energy. Sound or fan, many things. It creates magnet. One energy is transferred into other kind of energy. Everything is energy. And we can easily say, scientifically, the whole universe is clay of energy. One energy is transferred to the another energy, and that other energy also is not stable. It is transferred into some other energy. So everything is clay of energy. We have named it somewhere, somehow. Some names we have given for our day-to-day transaction to make it easier. We have named it, but basically the whole universe is a play of energy. And now, this energy is, wherever it is stagnant, or wherever it is stagnant means wherever it is repeatedly accumulated in one way, it becomes an object. Did you follow how the objects are created? What are you asking?
Mm-hmm.
एनर्जी यूनिवर्सल ऑफ कोर्स द एनर्जी मींस यूनिवर्सल दैट्स व्हाई आई एम एक्सप्लेनिंग व्हाट इज एनर्जी एनर्जी इज ट्रांसफर्ड इनटू अनदर एनर्जी सो माइंड आल्सो इज यूनिवर्सल माइंड आल्सो इज ए काइंड ऑफ एनर्जी So electricity also is universal. The energy is universal, and the whole universe is play of energy in different ways. So we have named it differently. Somewhere we call it prana, somewhere we call it mind, somewhere we call it differently. So everything is play of energy. Energy is nothing but vibration, and wherever the vibration is stopped due to some reason, and it is repeated in one way again and again, it forms something which we call object. And objects will be so many kinds, because the waves are different from each other. So the objects will be so many, and objects are created because of energy. And what is energy? Where from this prana? And why this prana vibrates? Why? Then we come to its source. Because of its impression, the throbbing, the push, the prompting, or the momentum given by the impression. What is impression? Again, we come to the circle. Impressions are created by this energy, which is called thought. Waves, when they perceive or understand some object or come back from the object, they come back with some impression. Impression means it is a kind of understanding, very very subtle understanding what it is. Understanding is impression, impression is understanding. Where is the post office? It is near the hospital. Where is the hospital? I told you it is near the post office. There is no other way to explain, because neither you have seen the post office nor you have seen the hospital. There is, we have to express in this way only. There is no other way to express it. Because we are talking about something which is not at all there. Yes.
Is this the same thing with matter and energy? Because energy
matter. Matter means object.
Because energy is movement, something has to move.
Yes.
So it has to be matter. But what is matter? It's made out of energy.
Yes.
Is this the same kind of circle?
Surely. We call matter sometimes, yes, using wordings, terminology is different. Matter and energy, we use these words in science, modern science. And this object and mind and prana, we use it in philosophy. Same thing.
My question is, Swamiji, though, prana or thought, something is moving. So what is moving?
Yes. What is moving? What do you understand by movement? Everything is confused. If you enter into the depth of the meaning, everything is confused. Superficially, everything we understand. And when we enter into the depth, nothing is understood. Nothing is understood. Anyway,
what is matter and what is energy then? And what is movement? What is movement? Really speaking, movement is a confusion. How I will tell you, I will give you the example. Have you seen the weaving machine in a factory, weaving factory? They make threads of different kinds, or they make cloths. So there will be some, I don't know exactly the names of those straps. There will be holes and threads will be there. So what happens? Continuously they will be going up and down, and in between the thread goes this side, that side, and the cloth is made. Have you seen this? So continuously those stripes will move up and down, and that if you see there, you will see a wave is going on continuously, but really there is no real wave. It is moving in one place, going up and down. So waves are created. Waves are confusion only, misunderstanding only. Did you follow? When you move some plates, say thousands of plates up and down in a line, so what will you see? You will see some waves going on. So those waves are not waves, it is misunderstanding only. Did you follow?
It's in your Upanishad Swami, like warp and woof. This is all questions about.
Like?
It's in the Upanishads, they put questions about it. Like warp and woof. It's like the making of a cloth. Gandhi is in one of the Upanishads.
Yes, yes. And when we go on analyzing elaborately, we find wave is not at all there. There is nothing which really can be called as energy. There is no energy. Energy is an appearance which is not there. Just as now I gave the example. Some waves are created and we see something is moving continuously.
So now serial light in the
serial
light, aise lagta ki light ja rahe the.
Haan?
Serial light, yes.
In some advertisements, in advertisement, beautiful example you have given. In the circle, the light is moving. We see the light is moving, but it is blowing and extinguishing at similar intervals. So we see the light is moving and zigzagly also, and it makes some words also, many things, designs. So many things can be created, but they are not at all there, but only the bulbs are on and off in equal intervals. That's all.
Even Swami, on cinema screen, everything is moving like cinema screen.
Yes.
Looks like live.
Yes. See, the man is walking. Really, the man is not walking. Nothing is happening. But we think the man is walking, he is running, he is speaking. Everything we see,
in the TV, in the cinema, video films, but it is continuous change. It creates the misunderstanding, and we think we are understanding. Because of this vibrations or continuous change, the misunderstanding or the confusion is created. And in this way, if we go on from one point to the other, analyze it impartially, then we understand there is no energy at all. Everything is in standstill position. See, if the fan will be moving in a very great speed, then you will see only the fan, it is in standstill position. Both way. If you see some object continuously for a long time, you will see some movements in it. And if you see some moving object very fastly, then you will see it is stagnant, it is not moving. Just the opposite we understand, just as we are moving in the train, we think the side trees are moving. The opposite we understand. This is our mind, the nature of the mind. And this is why? Because the structure of the mind is so. Mind is made in that way, to create misunderstanding. You cannot help it. And who are you to help it? You are the mind itself. So, our identity is nothing but a solid confusion. Now, in this way, objects are created, mind is created, and prana is created. Prana is forced to act or vibrate throughout the body because of its subconscious mind's prompting or the tendency given to the prana to act. So, this tendency is otherwise known as the absolute supreme energy, which is called Saraswati. The tendency to act in every object, whether living being or inert. There is a tendency to act. Some beings, they act very quickly or some effective ways or some visible ways. So it is called living being. Or some other objects, they don't do it in that way. They are called inert beings, living beings and inert beings. All these beings, they are nothing but play of prana, where prana works in a way, it is called living being. If it is not working in that way, it is very slow and very lethargic, then it is called inert being. But everywhere prana is there, energy is there. Somewhere it is visible, somewhere it is not visible. Visibility is grossness, invisibility is subtleness. Gross thing we call visible. Subtle things we call invisible. We don't see the sky, but yet sky is there. It is because of its subtleness. Air is invisible, but it is touchable, it is experienceable. We experience the touch of the air by our skin, so we understand it. But yet it is subtle, but grosser than the sky, because it is more experienced easily, so we call it gross. So all these words we have used in a particular way, and it is taught to us by our associates, kith and kin, our elders, our society. So we are trained in that way, to understand in that way. When the child is born, it knows nothing, but it has the old impressions within it. What are those impressions? To see and understand, to hear and understand. So our society, our beings around us, we call them relatives or kith and kin, our near, our neighbors, they give some impressions, and thereby we are trained to understand something. If I said, "He is your father," then we go on telling, "He is my father, he is my father, he is my father," he becomes my father. It is something given by others, some impressions created in our mind by others. And really speaking, we have nothing of our own. Child is trained by others. He has no training in the womb of his mother. So now, why he is trained? He wants to do something by old impressions. And where from those old impressions come? The impressions are created continuously, and they are multiplied continuously. The impression have their tendency within it. The tendency is to multiply. So they go on multiplying, and they never stop. The unending process of multiplication. That is called the secret of creation. One becomes many. One becomes many. That is the secret of creation. And that is the formula of creation also. When one becomes many, one becomes two, two becomes four, four becomes 16, then only we create. That is called creation. Multiplication or addition is called creation. So that is the formula, that is the rule. When you multiply, you create. How if one potato is there, if you cut it into four pieces, it is multiplied and it is understood as you have created four. Created four. One has become four. And if it is once started, it will not stop. It will go on dividing and multiplying. Division is multiplication. Did you understand how division is multiplication? But mathematically,
division is something else, and multiplication is something else. Dividing means you are minimizing, you are decreasing, and multiplying means you are increasing. But philosophically, division is multiplication, and multiplication is division. So when we analyze it in this way, then only we understand. There is no meaning in multiplication or division. So now coming to impressions, the scientific law and the philosophical law also, they are same. Law is, if one thing happens, if one incident happens, then it will go on happening. If it is quiet, if it is stand still, then it will remain as it is for eternity. If something happening means change, then it will go on changing for eternity. Nobody can stop it. So this is the law of nature, law of philosophy, law of science. If you, our Newton also says the same thing. If you give a momentum to a pendulum, if it is not obstructed by any other object, say wind or something, then it will swing till eternity. That's why they keep it in a vacuum and they experiment it. Give a momentum, it will go on swinging for eternity. So if something is created, it will go on being created for eternity. If it is stand still, then it will be as it is for eternity. There is no end to it. So now, if in the beginning we think the truth was there, logically we can prove that only one will be in the beginning. Logically we can prove also. How? Say now, how many you are? No, worldly wise.
In perspective.
You are two, you have got some children, say your family. For example, you are say 10. And before that, you were 2. Before that, you are 1. In that way, now the population of the world is, say, some 7 billions or so population. And 50 years back, was it so? It was less, and 100 years back, still lesser. So in what ratio it multiplies, in that ratio, if you go back, where will you reach? You are bound to reach in 1, isn't it? 1 has to multiply. It didn't happen ever in the case of our human society or animal society because of nature's play in between. So logically we have to reach 1 only, because we see practically everything is growing. And growing means, if you say it is growing, that means it was lesser before and more afterwards.
That is called growth. Logically, we have to go in this way. So, one day or other, billions of years before, there must be one. In the beginning of the creation, in the first morning of the creation, there will be one being. And that is called creator.
The big one, instead of the big bang, is the big one.
Correct. Correct. Scientifically also, and philosophically also, and logically also, and analytically also. You have to reach one in the beginning. There is no other way. And mathematically also. From every angle, if you see, we go and reach, stop at one. So in the beginning, that's why the Vedas say, or the great seers, research students, they are called munis, rishis, saints and sages. They did research for years, for lives, and they found out in the beginning there was only one. If one will be there, according to logic, according to philosophy, according to your science, where from whichever angle you see, that one will be one all the time, if it is not disturbed. Isn't it? Now we proved. If you give a momentum to a pendulum, it will go on oscillating for eternity. So, if one will be there in the beginning, it will be one only for eternity. There cannot be two. So, creation is deleted. There cannot be any creation. Okay? One cannot become two, because there was no two. If two will be there, other logic also support it. If two will be there, one will be cause and other will be effect. If you say both are causeless and only effects, then there will be question of bigger or smaller. If two is there, then opposition and class between them, and relation, everything will start. If two will be there, so many complications will be there. Relation will be there. What will be the relation between the two? And then what will be, either one will be bigger or other will be bigger. Then if one becomes bigger, the other becomes smaller. The comparison, relation, and communion, everything, so many things. In physics, if you go, so many complications will start. And from all those analyses, if we get time, then we can go on fighting in this way. There is no end to it. Then if you see from logic, from science, from philosophy, from analysis, from discrimination, from mathematics, from every angle of vision, we reach only one. And if one is there, it cannot be two. It cannot be two. This is the final conclusion. Why it cannot be two? If two will be there, then where it will stand? It will stand only on the basis of one. Where will it remain? If one is there, it is the time, it is the space, it is everything. It has to be all-pervading and everything it will be. So if two is created by chance, by some means, then where will it be? Where will it stand? What will be the base for it? Then the previous one will be the base for it. Then that will be the cause and second will be effect. So it will be subsidiary, isn't it? So if two is there, then four will be there. Because it has become two, so it has to become four. It cannot remain as two. In this way, there are so many subtle logics are there. From those logics, we come to the conclusion there was one and it wanted to see itself, to experience itself. It has to, if it experiences itself, that becomes the gross experience slowly, and it is called seeing. Experience when becomes gross, it is called seeing, means feeling. It becomes seeing. Seeing means through the senses. So it has to see itself, so it sees itself as many. Then there is the thought of second. When I am seeing, the seer is there and seen is there. Then logic comes again. If you are seeing, what are you seeing? The object you are seeing, that becomes objectified. The same one becomes the second. It sees itself. It becomes the seer, it becomes the seen, and the seen is called object. Did you follow? Very subtle logic. When you are seeing yourself, you are the seer and you are the seen. The seen is called object, the seer is called subject. Did you follow? No? See, if I want to see myself, how to see myself? You want to see yourself. What is the process? Either you should stand before a mirror and open your eyes to see yourself. Or you should touch yourself. Oh, I am. Yes, I am. Sometimes it happens when the legs become benumbed. You don't feel the sense in the leg. Then you doubt whether the leg is there or not. So you have to touch it. You have to see it. You have to hear it. So senses are created, and senses, you are the senses, where from you get the senses. So this way, when the confusion of or illusion of seeing yourself started, then this is the root cause of all the confusions. You are already there. Who will see whom? Now somehow or other, some ideas are seen in yourself that you are the seer, you are the seen, and you are seeing. This is the triads. We call it drashta, drishya, darshan. Triputi. We call it Triputi. Three aspects of yourself. You are there all the time. You are not changed. But you are seen in three aspects. So if you go before a mirror, what do you see? Do you see yourself? Your image or your reflection? Grossly. And that reflection is not at all there. But you think you are seeing yourself. What is a reflection? Reflection is your imagination. Your imagination. So it is not there, but it appears to be, just as the snake on the rope, the mirage, water in the mirage, just as the blueness in the sky or emptiness in the sky or torch in the wind. Now, from other angle also we can see. It is neither the self, nor it is different from the self. But yet it appears to be different than the self. Isn't it? So we call it confusion. It is neither one with the self, nor different from the self. Say we see the sun in the water, the reflection of the sun. Is it different from the sun? Is it one with the sun? You cannot say anything about it. So also the case with the world. World is said to be the reflection of the truth, absolute truth, which is one without a second. And where it is reflected, in the case of mirror, we say, I am different from the mirror, and mirror is transparent. So my image is seen in the, my form is seen in the mirror because of its transparency. And it is called image or reflection, and it is because of my presence. If I am not present, the reflection will not be there. So now, about the creation, if this mirror is flat and before you in one way, we understand something that this reflection is different from me and it is so clear, how can you say it is confused? It is so clear, I am clearly seen. As transparent as the mirror, so clear is the image. Now, if the mirror is round, what happens? How many reflections you will have? And which will be true? How many images you see? And if mirror is, of course it is transparent. If transparent lenses are before you all around, how many images you will see and how clear it will be? It will be so confused. One reflection, and that reflection is reflected in other reflection. That reflection is reflected in all other reflections. So every reflection is reflected in other reflections 1,000 times. size-wise, length-wise, breadth-wise, and size-wise, and so many confusion. You will go mad if you put a dog in the lens house, what will happen? That is what is happening to all of us, the human beings. We are less than the dogs. And yet we think we are human beings if we understand so much. What do you understand? You are my image, but I am thinking you are different from me. One image is thinking the other image to be different from itself. So in that way, all this numerology creates the confusion. Because all these are seen inside the arena. Arena means it is the arena of lenses. And what is lens? It is transparent and it has the power to increase and decrease, magnify or what is the opposite of magnifying? Minimizing. So in this way, the absolute truth, which is one and one alone, is seeing himself in different names and forms. This is how the objects are created. Objects means within it, not outside it. And seer also is he, within him. And seeing is called energy, activity. Seeing means verb. So verb means activity. That means energy. That is only an imagination. There is no energy. And if energy is there, it is universal. That means all pervading. And all the time, there cannot be any change in it. If no change, then how it is energy? So we come to the conclusion, it appears to be, but it is really not. Just like the waves in the ocean, it is only water seen as a wave. Whirlpools, bubbles, current, or the vapor, and it is ornament in gold, the instruments in iron. It is iron only. The cutter is only iron. The knife is only iron. Some confusion has made difference between the knife and the cutter. Knife cuts small things and cutter cuts more big things. And what is big and what is small? It is relatively understood. So there is no difference between a knife and cutter. It is only one thing. In the same way, the so many examples, the ornaments in gold or the water in the mirrors, the blueness in the sky, everything is one and the same. Say from other angle, if you see, where is the air? Where does air remain? Where is the air? It is inside the sky. Can it go outside the sky? And where is the fire? Can it go outside the air? Fire is nothing but air, oxygen or hydrogen or something. And where is water? Can it go outside the fire? Never it can. So in that way, the saints have told us, Vedas have told us, the earth is so big, and around the earth there is a sphere of water. It is inside water. A sphere of water 7 times more than earth, and fire is 7 times more than water, and air is 7 times more than the fire. Air is still 7 times more than the fire. And the sky is unlimited. It is covering everything. So everything is within it. So the absolute conscious sky is holding this elementary sky. If you cannot understand this elementary sky, how can you understand the conscious sky which holds this sky? So subtle, so transparent, so naturally it resembles, it glows. Its glowing is called world, and it sees its own glow. It itself sees its own glow, and it appears to be many. That is called world. Everywhere the existence, the consciousness, the knowing of it, bliss, everywhere it is present, so we call it the nature of the Absolute. And if all these will be there, naturally there will be a form and a name, and there will be multiplication, and multiplication creates confusion. Multiplication creates confusion. If it will be one, there is no confusion. So to see the world is difficult than to see the God. It is so simple to see the God, but nobody sees. See, it is so easy to see God because it is one. How easy is it to see the one? How difficult is it to see many? And we think it is so difficult to see God, and so easy we see the world. Just opposite, just opposite. Why we discuss all these? We were discussing about the individual being. From that we have come so far. Unless you come so far, you cannot understand what is individual being. Individuality is not at all there. To understand individual being, you have to understand what is multiplicity, what is manyness, because individual cannot be one. And how it is limited, how it is so narrow. So why and how it is multiplied? The impressions push the prana to vibrate. Prana pushes the mind to vibrate, and mind pushes others to vibrate, and that is the philosophical point of view of energy. And those impressions where from it is created in the beginning that I am one, let me be many, and it goes on multiplying, which is not at all there. So in this way, the moment you think to see yourself, you are the creator of yourself. So that is universal being. You are limited by yourself. Your limitation is yourself. So you are the universal being. Being means a limitation. Being means a limitation, somewhere. Universal being means unlimited limitation. Limitation which is unlimited. You can, just like infinite. What do you understand by infinite? Infinite means something which has no end, but we understand it. No beginning, no end. Then only it will be infinite. No boundaries, no limitation. And you have limited it by saying infinite. So in that way, all, what do you mean by all? Has it got any limitation? Yet we have limited all of you. All of you are welcome here. What is the number of all? So relatively something confusingly understood as the world and individual being. And if individual being is confused understanding, universal being also will be a confusion. And from higher point of view, there is no individual being, there is no universal being. Being is limitation. And if it is multiplied limitation, then it is called individual being. If it is one limitation, it is called universal being. If it is limited, it is confused. So, the whole world, whether you call individual being or universal being or the creation or the creator, everything is only your impression or your thought. And thought wave cannot become one, it is wavery. So this creator cannot remain as one. It has to multiply, it has to create. So individual beings are seen within itself. When I see my two eyes. I am one, I see my two eyes, ears, head, nose, mouth, heart, legs, everything I see as multiple, but yet I am one. I see all the multiplicity in oneness. This is how we have to understand the individual being. Being means being. In Hindi we say hona. What will be? Becoming means being. If you are not there, how you will be? And if you are there, what will you be? See the logic. If you are there, what will you be? Can you be something? You are already there. So the question is not at all there. You cannot be. And if you are not there, how can you be? What will you be? If you will be something, then what will you be? That this becoming is called being, and it is not at all possible. Did you see what are you? Your identity is gone forever and ever. You are no more there. Oh, what a pity! Did we come here to Yoga Vasishtha class to lose our identity? Yes. Yes, there is no more confusion. Nobody will ask your identity card. Neither in our aerodromes, or nor in railway stations, nor in bus stands. Nowhere you are to show your identity card, because you have no identity card, no ID card. So, I am. See what kind of fools they are. Even if you are standing before them, they ask you, show your ID card. What do you mean by ID card? Somebody has to identify you and give a proof. You are you. What a pity! Pitiable condition. Once I told so, I am standing before you. Somebody took my photo, and that photo is attached here in the paper, and you compare this and you agree that I am this. What a fool. I am standing before you and you are asking me ID card. This is the world. So, up to now we have understood little about the being. Now, why we discuss all this? To clarify that point, now the Vipaschit, who is sitting in the court of Dasarath before Rama and Vasishtha is present there, he is telling his stories, his experiences, and one of the stories out of his experience what he underwent is this story. Sometimes he was somewhere there in the forest. He practiced austerities. He became a great saint, and he met this saint. He was the hunter. The Vipaschit was the hunter, and he was hunting the animals in the forest. He came across the great saint, and he was advised by the saint to be in the ashram and practice something better than what he is doing now. What is better and what is worse? What is good and what is better? He asked, that saint asked that hunter, "Oh my dear, don't you think something will be better than this what you are doing?" Then he asked, "What is better and what is good? I am killing the animals and eating, and I am supporting my family. What is, how it is bad and what is better? Where is the better life?" So the saint explains him what is better and what is good. Killing is not bad, but it is only good if you support Kili. If you support Kili, it is only will be good. It will not be better. Something better life is there than killing animals and supporting your family. Then he asked, what is better life? Whatever little you get from this, your daily activities, you can get more, that will be better. And what is more, what you get from this killing, I get some satisfaction, some pleasure, some happiness. So there we go to betterment. We can achieve more happiness, more pleasure than this by doing some other activities. So he said, what is better? Then we can practice mercy, kindness, charity, and serving others, helping others, and their reaction will be more pleasant. The reaction will be there. Whatever you yield from those type of action, divine actions are something higher activities. Wherefrom we call it higher, because some more pleasure we can achieve by those actions. If we help others, if I helped you, I get some pleasure, and this pleasure is doubled. How? I get pleasure from myself, and I get pleasure out of your pleasure. So it is redoubled. And if I kill you, I get some pleasure, of course, by killing you. But that pleasure is decreased because of your suffering. Your suffering has also some influence over my pleasure. So my pleasure is decreased. And when you have pleasure and I have pleasure, the pleasure is enhanced. So it is better action. So in this way, logically and analytically, he made him understand that there is a better life, and be with me, practice something better. So the hunter stayed in the ashram and practiced the better life. That we call sadhana, better life. So, by the way, he put some questions about dream, waking, and sleeping. And by the way, when the guru was explaining all this, then he asked about the multiple suffering and group suffering and group enjoyments, how it happens, what is the law of actions, karma and karma theory. So it went on, and then the guru was relating the story how he entered into the womb of another disciple to do research on dream and other things. And in that dream state, how he experienced three lives, and how he became the householder, and in household life, how he came across a great saint by association with wise men, how he got enlightened, and there he wanted to see his previous body which is none other than the saint, the guru of the hunter, the Vipassit here. So now, unless we understand the identities or the individual being theory, how can you understand all these complicated individuals? So that great saint in the womb of the disciple, in the dream of the guru, and in that household life, that wise man who was enlightened by the stranger saint, he experienced the absolute, but yet he has some ideas of individualities. That's why he could not get the way out. Though he experienced the universal consciousness, yet he had some minute spot somewhere, the idea of individual soul. That's why he could not get the way out. Actually, if you are enlightened, then there is no in and out. There is no womb or holder of the womb. Nothing is there. So there is no question of going out or staying in. Because he wanted to see his previous body, that itself shows he had the idea of individuality. So he is trying to make him understand what is individuality. There is no individuality. Wipe out this idea from your understanding level. Then only you will become one with the Absolute. If you have this idea somewhere in you, then you will be searching for your previous life. Then what happened to previous life? Then it will go on unendingly. And that is the cause of this creation and confusion. If small, minute sparkle is there somewhere in the womb of the big heap of us, one day or other it will become the forest fire. Don't leave it there. The small particle of fire, some sparkle, it will become the forest fire. It will fire up thousands of forests one day. It will put you, this idea will put you again into the womb of the world. So forget all about. Don't believe in your previous life or afterlives. That's why he says, your previous body is burnt out. Jnana agni dagdha karmani. If you are wise, if you are enlightened, your bodies are burnt up. Jnana agni dagdha karmani tamahur panditam buddha. By the fire of knowledge, all your identities, your bodies, your individualities are burnt out. So why and how can you see your previous body? If some little trace of this idea will be there, it will be cause for your bondage again. Wipe out from its root. Neither you are the householder, nor I am your teacher, nor you have this family, nor you had entered into the womb of your disciple, nor you have seen this creations in the dream, neither you are in the dream, nor you are in the waking state. Nowhere you are. Your you are is lost forever. So don't think of your previous life or afterlife. To rub out everything from its root is makes him understand about individuality. Now we shall see further. Tomorrow, that means next year. There is no meaning in tomorrow or next year. You see, next year for us, or after 10 years for us, after 100 years for us, is after 1 hour for the person who is sitting in Neptune. 1 hour means our 100 years. So tomorrow means next year. Hari Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. सद्गुरु भगवान की जय. सच्चिदानंद भगवान की जय. शब्द ब्रह्म की जय. सरस्वती महारानी की जय. योग वशिष्ठ जी भगवान की जय.